In this tutorial, I will teach you about block diagrams and how to handle, for instance, inputs like RS or feedback like CS, the error term ES, the transfer function GS and XS from the last tutorial, or, for instance, the feedback itself, how it has to be put in the right unit with the transfer function H of S. I furthermore explain the closed loop transfer function, and together we will go over two examples and I show you how to bring this system into that form and this system into this form. Thanks for joining me.
Welcome back. Today we're dealing with block diagrams. Block diagrams are a nice way to illustrate systems and transfer functions. Last time we learned that, for instance, an input and a transfer function can be represented as such. Sometimes CS can be as well XS or Y of S. No matter what, it is the output. On the other hand, R of S can, for instance, be U of S. The next thing I'm going to show you is the error detector function or error detector node. So you have a signal coming back, which is minus. You have a reference signal, which is plus. This is mainly used for feedback control. So for instance, you have R of S and the arrow between this signal coming back, which I can, for instance, name C of S, is ES. So R of S minus CS can be equal to be E of S. It shows basically the difference between the reference signal and the actual signal which comes back. Speaking of closed loop systems, let me draw out, for instance, a closed loop system which we can try to analyze. You have a function G of S, there's an output X of S, and getting fed back to be compared to RS. We have to bring the unit of XS to the same unit of RS, and that's why we have in the middle of the feedback another block with the name HS. The error node sometimes is as well referred to as summing point. Now, let's look at a system which I call open loop transfer function. An open loop transfer function is nothing else than CS over ES equal to be GS multiplied by HS. So what does it say? It says basically we're looking at an output CS, which is this one, over an input ES, where it's getting multiplied by GS and HS. It's very simple. So from here to here. On the other end, we can, for instance, say we have as well a feed forward transfer function. A feed forward transfer function is nothing else than XS over ES equal to be GS. The path for the feed forward transfer function is from ES over GS to XS. Now, there's nothing more important than the closed loop transfer function. The closed loop transfer function. The closed loop transfer function is very important because it's mostly used in a lot of feedback systems and for stability analysis. In that case, let me write the system down. So we have this diagram in the sketch, and we can simply state X of S is going to be equal G of S multiplied by ES. Furthermore, we can claim that ES is equal to be RS minus CS. RS minus CS is going to be ES. And therefore, we can say it's RS minus. Now we can substitute for CS. CS is nothing else than HS multiplied by XS. Okay, so we can plug in the second equation into the first equation. 2 in 1 results in XS is going to be equal to GS multiplied by RS minus HS multiplied by XS. Now let me try to bring all the XS's over to one side. So XS plus GS, HS, and XS is going to be equal GS, RS. Now we have this equation. We can take out XS, and on this side we can divide by RS. That's basically what follows here. It's going to be equal to GS over 1 plus GS multiplied by HS, the term in the feedback. And that's a very important rule which you have to memorize when it comes down to the feedback loop. Now let me erase all that stuff. There are a couple of rules which are very important. For instance, there's a commutative property. What I mean by that, I can show you now. So let's say rule one. Rule one is you have an input coming A, you have a plus here, and you have a minus coming from this side. You can draw the plus or the minus inside, outside. That doesn't really matter for the rule. I just want to show you how it works. And that's going to be A minus B. On the other end, you have this one coming in positive, and you have a C coming in positive too. So this would want to be A minus B plus C. On the right hand side, you have the equivalence, which is basically A comes in as plus C. So I can flip those in between. So plus U2, it's going to be A plus C. And this is going to be a minus B coming in, and I have A minus B plus C. Those two systems are equivalent. Okay, for the next ones, I'm just going to draw the picture and then explain you what I did. The second law says nothing different than if I have, for instance, input A and C coming in and adding up, subtracting by B, I can just rewrite this by splitting up this node into two nodes by having A minus B first and then A minus B plus C coming in from the top. The third rule is the associative property of multiplication. For instance, if I have an A multiplied by a transfer function G1, results in AG1, this goes through a transfer function G2, it's going to be AG1, G2. I can just flip the G1 and G2 and have AG1, G2 as well. That's the same. What I can say as well is, I can just put those two transfer functions together to make a G1, G2, and then one block results in AG1, G2. The fourth rule says, if I have, for instance, an input A coming into G1, but splitting off to G2, and summing up again to be AG1 plus AG2, I can just put G1 and G2 as well into one transfer function instead of two separate, and multiply by A, and get AG1 plus AG2. The fifth rule says, if I have, for instance, an input A going through G, which makes it AG, subtracting minus B from that, that gives me AG minus B. That is equivalent to having an input A coming in, subtracted by an input B, which goes through a transfer function of 1 over G, makes it B over G. So the subtraction is A minus BG, and this whole term goes through a transfer function itself and results in AG minus B. Equivalent, so I can pull this B to the front, but I have to add 1 by G. The next rule says, if we have an input A and getting subtracted from an input B, resulting in A minus B going through transfer function G, that results in AG minus BG. We can split those up, give each input a separate transfer function G, and subtract them later to get the same result. The next rule says, if I have an input A and push it through a transfer function, I get AG and AG, while a network which splits off is basically indicated by a dot like such. But I can also say I split up before and then go through transfer functions and get as well AG and AG. The eighth rule says, if an input A, I can split it off before and get A, or push it through G and get AG, so go from left to right. The same is true if I push A through G and then later on split off and divide AG by another transfer function, 1 over G, I get A, but I get as well A of G on the top. The next thing says, I have two inputs getting subtracted and later on I can split them off. The same rule applies as here. I have A minus B and A minus B. Or I can split off separately and say A minus B is going to be A minus B, or I can push the A through and have a subtraction of B later. That results as well in A minus B. The next rule I can say is, I have an input which goes through G1 and G2, gets added up to make it AG1 plus AG2. Or I can have an input A going through G2, splits off, gets added, and on the other side is 1 over G2, so it's going to be a pure A afterwards again, multiplied by A, multiplied by G1, makes it AG1, and in the end I have AG1 plus AG2. Another rule says, I have an input A fed through G1, making B, and that's fed back by G2, and basically gets subtracted from A. The same can be said if I have A multiplied by 1 over G2, subtracted by B later on, but gets fed through G2 and G1. So here we have an example which I like to show you. You have an input RS going through a node, it gets subtracted by something. We look at this later. It goes through G1, gets then further pushed through G2, but before subtracted by XSHS. This then gets fed back and subtracted from the reference. However, on this side, we have a push through G3 and G4 and fed back from XS to the node here. So the first thing we gotta do, I'm taking my little towel here, we combine G3 and G4. So I'm combining G3 and G4. That's the first thing I'm gonna do. The next thing I'm gonna do is I wanna get rid of this feedback loop. I can simply use the closed form expression by erasing this terminology again and making it a little bigger. I'm getting first rid of this twig here. Okay, I'm making it a little bigger. And remember, I can just say it's G3, G4, the HFS, the feedback was basically unity, so one. This one means there's one here, so it's just technically G3 and G4, nothing else. Okay, so good so far. Now I would like to get this node moved over to this point. I can simply erase it here, add a block, and bring it over here. Now what do I have to write in here? I have to account for this G3 by G3 multiplied by G4. So I'm just gonna inverse this one. I have G1 plus G3 over G4 divided by G3 G4. Simple as that. So the next thing is, I can have this node free, so I can technically erase this part. Just connect those two. I'm getting G2 in here, very easy. I'm just erasing G2 and add it to this one. Okay, next I wanna take care of this feedback loop. Okay, how can I do this? I can get rid of this H and the twig which feeds back. It's negative. Negative feedback is very important, otherwise that plus one wouldn't hold here. I can simplify this one in such a way that I say it's G2, G3, G4. That's basically the numerator. And the feedback down here gets now multiplied by, for this part, I can do a little side calculation and I can just say G3, G4 is basically numerator, 1 plus G3 and G4 over 1 plus this whole term again, G2 is G3, G4 over 1 plus G3, G4 multiplied by H. Now you can see you multiply this one over here, common numerator, denominator. This cancels out. So these ones cancel out. I just have to put a G3, G4 here. That's basically it. So I can write down G2, G3, G4 over, let me go chronologically. So 1 plus G3, G4 plus G2, G3, G4, H. That's basically this term with the feedback loop. And now I'm multiplying the G1 over here. That's very simple too. And after I'm done with this one, I have to close the loop here. I think you can do this exercise at home. It's not too difficult, but what comes in the end out of this function is basically RS gets multiplied by a whole big term, G1, G2, G3, G4 over 1 plus G3, G4 plus G2, G3, G4, H plus G1, G2, 1 plus G3, G4. Okay, and this is going to be X of S. Try it at home. I think it's pretty easy if you do that in this way. Again, you can see here somehow it's going to be this in the numerator, the G1, G2, G3 over this term, but we know we have to multiply the 1 plus this term multiplied by the feedback. It's again negative feedback, so it holds a plus sign. And you bring this part to the top, the things cancel out, and you result with this equation. Next example is this function. So you have an input R, which goes through, gets subtracted by H4 and XS, that's for later, goes through, there's a feedback loop here consisting of G1 and G4, and an H1, this gets pushed further through a G3 and a G2, added up later and becoming X of S. The first thing I'm gonna see here is that this is a positive feedback loop, very important. But however, we can multiply G1 and G4, bring it over H1, G1, G4, 1 minus, because it's a positive feedback, G1, G4, H1. Okay, now the next thing I'm going to see is the G3 and G2 can be added together to be simply G2, G3 with a plus in between. And this can now be multiplied with each other. So I'm just bringing those two guys in here, G2 plus G3. And now the feedback loop, which is in this case negative, can be applied, which is simply, again, using this one divided by 1 plus this whole term multiplied by H2. You can do it at home. This brings me to the end of my video session. If you like what I'm doing, please subscribe or press a like button. That would support me. I really enjoy teaching you this material, and I hope I see you in the next lecture.